He's been good to us, hasn't he? Yeah, so Father, we thank you just for the gathering that we've had this weekend. We give you praise and honor and glory. And we declare that all glory goes to you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. It's been a great, great weekend. Great, great weekend. We're going to receive tithes and offerings this morning. And so if our ushers could get ready and come on down here, that would be great. We're not going to do the slides we typically do for stewardship. And so we're going to just go ahead. And if you're writing out a check, you can make it payable to HIFC or Harvest International Family Church, whichever is easiest for you. So ushers, if you could come on down, we're ready. How many of you love to give? Yes? Yes. Some of us do. Yeah, it's a joy to give. It's more blessed to give than to receive, right? Yes. And the Bible says give, and what will happen? It will be given, right? And he says to test them with the tithe. Bring the whole tithe, right? Into the storehouse. And so, Lord, we thank you right now for this privilege that we have, God, that you bless us. Lord, you bless us with jobs and resources. And God, this is a time that we can sow back and honor you. And so we pray, God, that you would bless this seed sown and cause, Lord, jobs and better jobs to come to your people. Open up great opportunities. Lord, let there be great contracts to come. We thank you for opening up the windows of heaven over your people. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so if you're ready, you can go ahead and bring your tithe and offering up to the ushers that are here. Nate, you ready? All right, as you're finishing with that, we are going to be launching a video program now that we can live stream and be out there. And so we'll have at times a panel of folks, and we've had different ones share throughout the gathering this weekend. And they've done a great job, haven't they? I mean, a great, great job. I'm impressed with them. And so Nathan right here is our son-in-law, and we have been very, very blessed to really have him added to our family. And he and Melody have given us three wonderful grandbabies, of which we are very thankful. Yes, that's right, Pushbear, amen. and Nathan is a great, great guy. So would you give him your undivided attention as he just shares from his heart?
Thank you. It's so hard to know which direction to go, right? That second song we were singing today, Be Lifted High, really is my heart. You know, Lord, be lifted high, you know. I'm nothing without you. And really, that's my heart, is to please God, to see him lifted high, you know, that he would be pleased with the decisions that I make, the things that I do. And really, it's my heart's desire that people would please God, that the church, that the body would be ones who please God. And I was asking, you know, what do you want me to speak about, God? And he was talking about how we need to be people who go to him first. That it's so easy to leave him out of situations when we're in our daily walk, you know. We're just going through our day. It's so easy to make him the last course of action, you know. I know that I've said it myself, and I've heard other people say it. I'm sure you've heard yourself say it. You know, I've done everything that I know how to do. I've done everything that I should, you know. Maybe now I'll pray, you know. Or, you know, I've done everything that I know that I can do. Would you pray for me now that God would help me through this? And it's easy for us to leave God out of the situation and cause him to be our last resort, you know? But it's been my heart's desire to put God first in every situation. When we come up against things, and I've come up against large things in my life, and when you go to God and say, you know what, God, what do you have to say about this situation, right? I've been amazed at the clarity that he's spoken. And then when you're in different situations, you know, this is where God has me. It's so much easier to go forward when you know that you're where God's called you to be. And when you come up against hard situations, you can say, you know what, this is where God wanted me. I know that he's going to be with me because he told me this is where I'm supposed to be. And, you know, I've kind of been spoiled getting to hang out with these guys. I've had access to different situations and different people that not everybody has access to. But it's been amazing the words that God has spoken and the clarity that's been there. You know, when you ask God something, you're like, God, speak into this situation. And then he speaks with clarity and you're like, oh my goodness, you know, now I got to do that thing. But you know what? We can't be a people who are just wandering around. It's so easy to say, oh, I'm going to take this job over there because it seems good in the natural. I'm going to move to this place over here because it's a nice place to move. But we need to be men and women who seek God first, you know, who say, God, what do you want me to be doing? Where do you want me to be living? Where do you want me to be working? And that's when we're going to find ourselves coming out of the desert, coming out of the wilderness. You know, we don't have time to spend wandering around in the wilderness, right? I mean, the times is drawing near, you know. We need to be men and women who know what we're doing, know where we're going, and can discern the times around us. And it's by going to God first and finding out what he has to say about the situation. And, you know, he was just speaking to me that verse, what is it, Matthew 6:33. Everybody knows that, seek ye first the kingdom of God, you know. Seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added to you. So if we go to God first, then everything else is going to line up, right? So we need to be men and women who know where we're going, what we're doing, and we can discern the times around us. So let's go to God first and see what he has to say of the situation and desire to please him in all we do.
That was good. That was really good. How many know we need the reminders? Remember when Peter said, as long as I'm in this tent, I'm going to stir you up by way of reminder. And so we need the reminders. Great job, Nathan. Really great, great job. We have been incredibly blessed this past weekend, having Paul Keith with us and Natalie, his daughter, traveling with him. She's a beauty, isn't she? Yes, she is. And may the beauty of the Lord rest on you. I just have felt that. May the beauty of the Lord. I want the beauty of the Lord on me, right? Would every volunteer for this gathering that we've just had, would you stand for us? Look at this. This is amazing. I enjoyed, stay standing. I enjoyed even watching, like, Jesse's on the camera over here. I know Gideon loved it, right? Is he? Oh, Gideon, there you are. Wow, I love that. I love that. I'm telling you, we could not have done what we've done without your help. I don't know where Kathleen is, Paul, but she's some. Oh, there she is. Okay. I was thinking, you're not here by yourself, are you? No. And I think about when we were down here working this week just to get things ready, and Lydia one day says, well, I'm going to bring you over a meal. Well, she brought over every part of the meal that you would eat, even to the dessert. It was like, it was so nice. And I think about Mike giving all his time after school and Bill Bushnell about living here and then driving every night an hour home. Sometimes they would get home at 1 o'clock in the morning. Bob would come in and we are so, so blessed. I know, please don't take offense if I didn't mention your name, all right? But I am like so impressed with all of you. Harvesters, thank you for going the extra mile and pouring in that this gathering would be a success. So hats off to all of you. And if you could all just stand and give them a round of applause for the work that they did. Thank you. John, I don't think you were standing. I just realized you just stood up. John came all the way from the Syracuse area and served up here on the electric guitar. Am I doing that right? Electric? Yes. And then Stephanie came down from the Syracuse area. We are a very blessed, blessed people. Very blessed, blessed people. I love that the harvesters are, I say, you're hardy people. Hardy people. Remember the scripture in Micah, do not rejoice over me, my enemy, for though I fall, I will arise. How many know that's what harvesters are? We keep rising up. And thank God that he's given us the cream of the crop in all truthfulness. That was a prophetic word a number of years ago when we just launched the church. And the Lord said, I will give you the cream of the crop. And he has done that. We are very incredibly blessed to have all of you a part in serving us. And so pat yourself on the back today and say, job well done. As we were coming into the meetings the first night, Thursday night, I came downstairs and Melody was standing in the dining room and she asked me a question and I went to pull my blouse up to look at my time. And I had two watches on. I was like, what in the world am I doing? And we laughed and laughed. And I said, God, I know you're speaking about something. And all I kept hearing was, it's time. And then Paul Keith talked about that here. And what is it time for? It's time to see. I really believe that. And I was awakened this morning every hour, reminded of the two watches. And so every hour on the hour I was awakened and I was saying to the Lord, what are you saying about time? It's time to see. And then I was hearing, though I once was blind, I now can see. It is a day of the Acts, I believe, of the apostles. The greatest days are right here in front of us. And I'm telling you, God is building a platform for the church to arise and shine. And it's going to be the glorious days, troublesome days. We know in the last days, perilous times will come. But God's people will arise and be strong because we know him and we will do great exploits. Can you say amen? So we have opportunity this morning to sow again into the supernatural. I believe this is the time. It's the time for the supernatural to be stirred in the midst of every one of us. Really what Nathan was saying is that we put God first in every part of our life. We seek him at the very beginning of our day. I remember years ago, Steve Hill said, if you don't wake up thinking about Jesus, you're backslidden. If you don't go to bed thinking about Jesus, you're backslidden. That's been a great challenge in my life, and we have to pursue it. How many know we've got to pursue God? And so it is time for the supernatural. I'm believing for it. And when Paul Keith showed R.W. Schombach last night, I was coming out of my skin. I had to stand up. I felt like taking off running out in the field. It is a day that God is outpouring the stirrings of his spirit within his people. And I'm saying, just like Josh was talking about, I'm in all the way. I don't want just my feet to be wet. How many of you know when Jesus got back in the boat with Peter, there were only two sets of feet that were wet that day? God wants all of us to jump in. So we're going to sow this morning into the supernatural, receiving an offering to bless White Dove Ministries. You can make checks payable to, is it HIFC or Ignited? HIFC this morning. And dig deep and sow deep. And let's believe God for the supernatural to be stirred up in each one of our lives. You know, we've talked at different times about preparation, being prepared for the days that we're in, you know, stocking up, whether it's on food or whatever. And I believe this, we need to just seek God and do what God tells us to do. And I've said this, I would love to have enough food to feed the whole neighborhood if something were to happen. But it would be just as exciting to see a hamburger multiplied to feed the multitudes. We pray and we obey, and it's the same in our giving. We pray and we obey. So, Father, here we are. We thank you that we have this opportunity to sow into White Dove Ministries. God, we bless this ministry. We pray, God, increase to come to this ministry, that you would expand even, Lord, their influence and impact. We thank you for touching this ministry with a fresh touch from heaven. In Jesus' name. And God, I pray that you speak to us. What do you want us to give and to sow? Let us walk in obedience before you, pleasing you in everything we do. Amen. Amen. All right, ushers, are you ready? Come on down. It's kind of like The Price is Right, right? Come on down. And you know what happens when they come on down? There's excitement, right? So how many of you want to get excited when you give today? You might want to get excited with expectancy, because I believe the supernatural is being stirred and we're all a part of it. All right, so why don't you stand to your feet? You might want to dance down the aisles, I don't know. Okay, go ahead and bring your offering. This is Tad Rowley over here on this camera, and we love Tad. Yeah. One of the things I love about Tad is you would never know he's ever having a hard day. Never. He's always up in spirit, and I love that about him. May it become contagious with all of us. Amen. All right, so we are very, very blessed to have Paul Keith Davis. I think this has been the richest that I've ever heard from him. You're always good. I mean, really. But there is something I was telling Bob. This has been so good and rich. And one of the things that I know is, I prophesy a lot, and I can always tell when somebody's hungry to hear the word of the Lord, and it pulls it out of me. And there's times that I say I could prophesy a book to somebody, and it's because there's hunger and expectancy within them. And so let's all put a hand on our well this morning. And Lord, I pray for a hungering right now, an expectancy in our spirits. And Lord, that we would pull out of this vessel that you've poured into all that we need for the season that we're in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Now, if you could just put your hands together and welcome Paul Keith.
Thank you. Awesome. Thank you so much. Be seated. Thank you. That's very, very kind. It's been a good weekend, hasn't it? I have really enjoyed myself, and it's just been wonderful. You know, I'm glad to see Diane still here. I didn't know. Listen, I got to tell a little story about Diane before I get started. We were in a conference in Syracuse several years ago, Bobby Connor and myself, and on a Saturday, we were going to be at the church all day. One of us spoke, had a luncheon at lunch, and then somebody was in the afternoon, somebody that night. So someone was preparing a big pot of soup, right? It was soup, wasn't it, Diane? For us to eat for lunch. So one of us did the morning session. I forget which one it was. And during the night, the Lord spoke to Diane and said, there's poison in the pot. And unbeknownst to the person cooking it, you know, something, was it spoiled meat or something had gotten in it? Something. Anyway, it was bad. And she had this word of the Lord, you know, you can't serve the stew. How would you like to go to a woman who's been cooking all night long and tell them you cannot serve what you've been, but it turned out it was bad, wasn't it? So praise the Lord for Diane. So I didn't get sick. But I like that. Isn't that good when you get prophetic words just about stuff like that and little things that are seemingly unimportant but very important? Well, it's just been a great pleasure. I've enjoyed it thoroughly on every level. The hospitality has just been awesome. It's been really good to be with you guys. Wanda said, tell you hello again, and she's sorry she wasn't here. But we sure think a lot of Bob and Kathy and their family, and hopefully, you know, Lord willing, we'll be back one day. We'll just see what happens, but the Lord willing, we'll do that. But I sure have enjoyed it. It's been very fruitful for me as well, and for Natalie. You enjoyed the video last night of our open. I was actually in that meeting. That meeting was called Mighty Warriors Conference at Benny Hinn's Church in Orlando, Florida, and I had gotten the Holy Spirit in 1989, and just so happened I had 2.5-3 years I was living alone out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, I was in Mississippi then, and I was in rural Mississippi. How many of you know that's the backside of the desert? I was living in a house out in the middle of nowhere, not even anybody within miles, and I wasn't sure who was going to kill me first, the devil or God, because every night one of the two of them was showing up. And it was just, how many of you know when you're in a house by yourself, even as a big old man, you know, I'm like, you know, and things are happening spiritually, and God was dealing with me. And so I began to have these experiences, and I was taking places. I was seeing things. Had no grid for it, had no real foundation of understanding, and I began to discover much of what I was being taught through ministries of people that are already passed on. And so by 1991, I was ready to meet somebody. I was ready to have some kind of exchange with someone that was doing some of the same sorts of things. And so I ended up, the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to go to this meeting down in Orlando, which I did, and didn't know a soul, flew down there. It happened to be that Bobby Connor was there also, but we didn't know each other. And so we had this conference, you know, and Shambach was there, and he shared the story, and it was kind of an amazing meeting. And then later that year, the Lord spoke to me and said, I want you to go to Israel, and I'll speak to you. So obviously, you know, I thought I'll go to, he didn't say who with or anything, so I kept watching for which ministry I was to go to Israel with or what trip it was to be. And I remember John Hagee had a brochure that somehow made its way to my desk, and I was in business then. I was doing really well, very successful in business. And so, you know, I thought maybe that's it, but I didn't really feel a connection to it. I didn't really feel like it was right. And so a brochure comes along. I guess I was on the mailing list now because I attended that conference where R.W. Shambach shared that story. And I get this brochure about Benny Hinn taking a group to Israel, and the Lord said, that's the one. So I ended up, you know, registering for the conference, and they had a little, the ability to pay $500 extra, which in 1991 may be a little bit more than it is now, but you pay $500 extra and you get a room by yourself. And so I thought, I don't want to be with anybody. I sure don't want to be in a room with some guy I don't know, or sure to a woman I don't know either. But anyway, that sounded kind of weird, didn't it? You know, but anyway, I didn't want to be in the room with anybody. Let me just say it that way. So I pay this. It's kind of humorous because when I got there and we checked in the hotel in Jerusalem, you know, I go into my room, and my room was a boardroom. Literally, it was not a bedroom. It was a boardroom with a big, long board table with these big chairs all around it, and they had put a cot in the room, and, of course, it had a full bathroom. And I'm like, I'm okay with that. You know, I don't necessarily need all this stuff here. So I put all my luggage and everything on the board table. So I had plenty of room to lay everything out, you know, so that was my room. And some amazing things happened on this trip. I received my first commissioning into ministry. And I'm going to lead into some things. I want to talk a little bit this morning about apostolic and the amount of time we have left. And I want to just kind of tell some of which of how this thing was birthed in me. But I was not interested in having fellowship with anyone. I'm not a real extroverted person anyway. I do what we do this way. But by nature, I'm very introverted. I can be alone by myself for days at a time. I know that's kind of weird. But I wasn't there to meet people. I wasn't really trying to, because God said, I'm going to speak to you. And so I'm thinking, okay, Benny Hinn's going to call me out and prophesy to me. That's what I kind of thought, And so two or three days into the trip, and of course there were like 25 buses or more, a couple of thousand people. And on my bus were a number of people, which I didn't know anybody. But by the third day, we make our way to the Dead Sea. And a lot of the guys on the bus had taken clothes, and they were out floating in the Dead Sea and all that, and I had no interest in that whatsoever. I was there to hear God. That was it. I mean, I went along with the tour because that was necessary, but God said, I'm going to speak to you, and I was waiting to hear what he had to say to me. And so I'm standing by the Dead Sea, and I happened to hear, I had noticed this little lady on our bus. Her name was Miss Aline Davis, had the same last name as me. She was a lady just about reached my shoulder, not quite my shoulder height, maybe weighed 100 pounds, maybe. And I didn't know her then, but I had noticed her, I'd seen her, and I happened to be standing there, and she said, I sure would like to walk out in the Dead Sea. And I thought, well, I'm standing here, all the other guys are out there. I said, Miss Davis, I'll walk out there with you. So I took off my boots, and I rolled my jeans up, about shin deep, and I took Miss Davis by my right arm, and we walked out about shin deep in the Dead Sea, and we're just standing there. I'm just thinking, I'm going to bless Miss Davis. And so she's just looking straight ahead. I'm right here, and she doesn't look at me. She's just looking straight ahead, And she said, I've seen him. Just like I said, you've seen who? I've seen him. And I said, tell me about it. And she said, when I was 14 years old, I lived on a plantation outside of New Orleans, Louisiana. And she said, my job was to take care of the boys. I was 14. I had no family, had no relatives, and basically lived the life of a slave, even though this was in the late 1800s, or early 1900s, I should say. She was born in the late 1800s. Because when I met her in 1991, she was only 95. And so she said, I've seen him. I said, what happened? She said, I was 14 years old, and one day I went into a field weeping because I had no family. And all of a sudden, a thunderstorm came up. I'm not sure if you've ever been to the South, but in the South, if a thunderstorm comes, you think God's mad at you. I mean, lightning and thunder and rumbles. I mean, it'll blow in and blow out, but I mean, it's just for a few minutes, it's like chaos. And so she said, I was in the middle of this thunderstorm, and she said, I noticed that under the tree that I was sitting under, no rain was touching me. I wasn't getting wet. She thought that was kind of odd. And she said, I looked across the field, and there stood a man in a white robe. And in a moment of time, instead of him being across the field, he was standing directly in front of me, and it was the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, this is the 1991 version of me. And I said, well, Miss Davis, were you seeing a vision, or were you in a tent? And she looked at me, and she said, he was there. Like, just shut up and listen. Right? She didn't say that, but that was what was communicated. Just listen. And the Lord said to her, turn to the east. And she said, I turned to the east, and in the distance I could see a man in a white robe, and in a moment of time, he was standing right next to me. He had a robe reaching to his feet. He was barefooted, had olive complexion, no beard, black hair down to his shoulders, and he sang a psalm to her. That's what she said. And the Lord said, look to the west, and she looked this way, and same thing. Angel stood right next to her, blonde hair this time, olive complexion, no beard, robe reaching to his feet, and he read John chapter 14 to her audibly. And, of course, that began her journey with the Lord. There's some other things that went on, but I'm sitting here thinking, I'm realizing, okay, Lord, you said you're going to speak to me. You got to realize I've been spending all these hours and days out by myself, in the woods, learning about the revelatory realm, reading about visitations, never really having a real visitation like that. But and here she was telling me this story, and I realized this was my encounter. I realized that. It wasn't going to be Benny Hinn that was going to call me out. It was Miss Aline Davis, this little tiny lady. And so we went over to the shore, and I put my boots back on, and I said, Miss Davis, you got to pray for me. And she said, okay. So I sat on the bench because she was very short, and she put her hands on my shoulder, and she said, Lord, just like that, Lord. And I knew whatever was about to come out of her mouth, God was going to hear it. I'm thinking, okay, I want the mantle of Smith Wigglesworth. I want the revelation of William Branham. I want the presence of Catherine Coombe. You know, that's what I'm thinking, because that's what I've been studying. And she said, Lord, like that, give him wisdom. And I was disappointed. That shows you how much I needed wisdom. Because I didn't even have enough wisdom to appreciate the value of wisdom. So some other things were said, and that was my first commissioning into ministry. That little Miss Aline Davis. And it dawned on me, wow, you know, this little lady has only been walking with Jesus 84 years. And I mean, she was a feisty little, I will tell this one little story just to let you know how much God. So after that, she had a new son. I mean, I didn't let her out of my sight. I mean, wherever she went, I went. We were together, and I helped her along. And her daughter was there to take care of her on this trip, and she was only 77. And so I took it upon myself to help her wherever we went, and we talked and chatted and all that. So finally the day came to go to the Via Dolorosa. And I'm not sure if you've ever been to Israel, but when you do that, when you walk the Via Dolorosa, you basically are committed to walk through the city because there's no place for a car or a bus to go. The bus drops you off at the starting point, drives around the city, and waits for you when you walk through. So it's a, you know, it's a commitment. And here she was. She had a walker, but she's 95 years old. And so she said, I really feel like I can do it. And I said, okay. So our group took off walking, but I stayed back and walked with her, you know. And we're about a third into it, about a third of the way into the Via Dolorosa. An absolute true story, as the Lord is my witness. And she stops and she turns to me and she says, I'm not going to make it. She says, I just can't do it. My legs just aren't going to work. I just can't do it. So I'm standing there thinking, okay, what are my options? I could pick her up and carry her, because I'm not sure if you've ever seen an image of the Via Dolorosa, but it is congested. I mean, there's people selling leather goods, trying to sell olive carvings, clothing, trinkets. I mean, it's just a congested, you guys ever been there? It's a congested area full of commerce and people trying to sell you stuff and people everywhere. I mean, and it's really not a very spiritual thing at all, to be honest with you. It had meat hanging on. I remember how they had this meat in open markets, you know, all on the Via Dolorosa. And so we stopped for a minute. She said, I'm not going to make it. And I'm thinking, what are my options? I could pick her up. I could go back this way. So while I'm thinking about what I'm going to do, I hear a car down the way to my left, and I hear a honking of the horn, and the car drove up on the curb and went around people and back on the street, honking along the way, pulled up. And I'm thinking, you know, wonder what this guy's doing while I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to do with Miss Davis. What are my options? Do I carry her? What do we do? She can't walk any further. And as the Lord is my witness, I'm standing there thinking, what am I going to do? And Miss Davis, out of her mouth, said, I need a taxi. And no sooner had those words come out of her mouth, that car that was honking, driving all over the place, come up, pulls up to where we're standing, rolls his window down and says, does anybody need a taxi? True story. I'm not sure if that was a real taxi or not. I don't know. But she says, I do. And she hops in the taxi and goes around. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that an amazing story? Well, she and I became fast friends. We talked all the time. She always had me sending pictures of my family to her. She prayed for them. And we remained friends until she went home to be with the Lord at the age of 106. So we stayed friends for 11 years. I remember, you know, I'm talking about authority. I'm kind of leading into authority. But I remember one time she and I were talking on the phone, and we were just chatting about things. And she said, you know, I had to go down to the church. She said, I can't go to church every day because my bones hurt. That's what she would tell me. And I said, I understand. And she said, but they called me down to the church. They were having some trouble. And I said, really? What kind of trouble? She said, well, the people were, she lived in Los Angeles, California. And the church apparently wasn't in the best part of town. And so she said, a lot of the ladies, as they were going into the church, there were some hoodlums, that's what she called them, standing on the corners, and they'd grab the purses and run off with the purses and all of that. So they called me to come down and deal with it. I'm thinking, okay. I think she's about 104 by now, 103. This was, you know. So I said, they called you to come deal with it. And she said, yeah, yeah. So I had to go down and deal with it. And I said, well, how did you deal with it? Oh, she said, I went down to those boys. She said, I stood in front of them. She said, you know, Boys, you're cursing the Lord. And you're cursing God with every breath. And the very God that gives you the breath to curse him, I know him. I talk to him all the time. I see him all the time. And she said, you know what? If I were to ask him to strike you dead right now, he would do it. And she said, in fact, I have a good mind to do it right now. That's what she said. And I said, what did they do? She said, well, the last time I saw them, they were running. And she's told, she said, now, you know I wasn't going to really do that. Like, if she had, you know, something was going to happen. She said, you know I wasn't going to really do that. She said, I just want to put a little fear in them. I said, yes, ma'am. I wouldn't want you sicking God on me either, so... Unless it's in a good way. That gives me hope, doesn't it, you? I was in Tucson, Arizona, hosting a conference. I'm going to have to. Natalie, you mind come grabbing this? I was in Tucson, Arizona, hosting a conference a few years back. I hosted a conference 5 years in a row up until last year. And I had mentioned the other day that I had brought in Paul Allen, the son of A.A. Allen, to share some testimonies, which he did. But he had a friend with him. I didn't know the man at all. I had never met him, never heard his name. But it turns out he was an organist for A.A. Allen and Jack Coe and William Branham and several of the people back in those years. Of course, he was elderly when I met him. But he was a young man back in the 60s and was apparently a very gifted organist. And so he would play the organ for these big healing campaigns and all of that. And so Paul Allen introduced him to me. And we began to talk. And he began to tell me the story because he knew that I loved William Branham. And he said, I'll never forget my last time I played for Brother Branham. I said, well, I'd like to hear about it. He said, it happened to be in Phoenix, Arizona, over at a certain cafeteria. The Full Gospel Businessmen's Association had hosted a meeting, and Brother Branham was the speaker. And he said, I played the organ in the meeting. And he said, now, you got to realize I'm this young, maybe 20-something-year-old kid playing the organ for a man like William Branham. You can just imagine what the honor would have been. And so the meeting ended, and Brother Branham walks over to him and says, would you like to go to lunch with me? He's like, are you kidding me? I mean, you know, why is William Branham asking me to go to lunch with him with all these ministers here that could have gone? And so he said he did. And I think Brother Branham maybe had an idea that he would carry something over into our day. And so he said the two of us went to the cafeteria and had lunch. And he said after lunch, we walked out into the car, into the parking lot, and Brother Branham was talking to him about some, and he realized Brother Branham was prophesying to him. He realized the conversation was prophetic. And Brother Branham makes this statement. He says, now, you know, first of all, what he did is he opened the trunk of the car and he took out a rifle. Brother Branham was an avid hunter. And some people that owned Winchester, the Winchester Gun Company, had gotten healed in some of his meetings. And as a result of that, to bless him, they had custom-made a rifle just for him with his name engraved on it and had given it to him as a gift. And so he went to the car and he took out the rifle and handed it to this man and let him look at it and whatever. And then he said, now, you know, he said, I think this guy said, well, you know, I guess you'll have a lot of good hunts with this rifle. And Brother Branham said, no, I'll never get to use it. Now, this is 1965 and Brother Branham was 56 years old. And the man says, what do you mean you'll never? He said, I'm about to go home. I'm about to leave you. The Lord's done with me. He said, my calling is over with. I've done what I'm supposed to do. And the Lord has shown me I'm about to go home. And, of course, he goes, no way. You're a young man. He said, I can actually help you with the meetings. I know how to do radio advertising. That's what he said. He said, that shows you how carnal I was. And he began to tell him, oh, no, we'll get the meetings going, and you'll just have all the great healing campaigns like you did before. And Brother Branham said, no, that's not going to happen. I'm about to leave you. And then can I read to you what he said to him? Brother Branham said, I'm about to leave you because God's changing the season, but another season is coming. This season is going to be of teaching and of revelation of the word of Jesus Christ and who we are in him and who he is in us. He said, Brother Branham went on to emphasize, it's about Jesus in us and us in him. The teaching season will go for a while and then it will come to a close. And then God will birth another new and final move upon the church world. Brother Branham went on to say, in this coming new season, God will bring to the forefront the ministry offices of the true apostles and the true prophets, and they will know the power of God like we never experienced in church history since the days of Pentecost. I believe we're there. You know, the prophecy was he was about to go home, and he did. I think that was maybe 2 months later he went home to be with the Lord. And we've had this teaching season, have we not? More teaching material has gone worldwide than ever before. more ability to communicate the message we've been given has been given ever before. Every time there is about to be a fresh new move of God on the Spirit, there is always a breakthrough in communication. Many people say the one thing that launched the Great Reformation as much as anything was the invention of the Gutenberg press. You know, people say that Martin Luther was the first to begin to print the Word of God into the language of the common man. The reality was he was not. Wycliffe was the first one, but the problem was the only way he could mass produce it was to write it. And you know, that's kind of limiting. But when Martin Luther comes along, the Gutenberg press has been invented, where you could take something, put it on a piece of paper, and you know, crank the thing up, and it mass produces the Bible. I think it was the Book of Romans, wasn't it, that he first translated into the language of the common person, and began to release the message of Reformation. And many of the historians say that invention, that mechanism, that tool, did more to launch the Great Reformation as the message itself. Then, of course, you come along, and there are many, many other cases throughout history where you see that, but especially in the days of the charismatic renewal, when this teaching movement that he's speaking of here came into its fullness, when you have Kenneth Hagin and all the other guys teaching about faith. And I believe Kenneth Hagin's message on faith was balanced. Maybe some other people took his message and went outside the boundaries with it, but I believe what Brother Hagin had was a balanced message. And so, you know, here you have those messages go forth, and they say the thing that launched the charismatic renewal more than anything else was the invention of the cassette tape, because the messages were mass-produced and went out all over the world. That was you can imagine how cutting-edge that was to have a cassette. We don't even have a cassette player anymore, do we? I have one because I still have some old tapes I go back and listen to, and it's a little battery-operated deal, you know. And so now here we are, on the precipice of something of significant nature. And look at the communication skills. Right now, as I'm speaking, anyone can be watching this message anywhere in the world that has a computer. Webinars, blogs, and all that goes with it, iPods. So I believe the stage is set for a monumental release of revelatory truth like we've never seen before. And I believe this word. I believe this is a true word. And I said last evening, we've been living between two peaks. We've been living between the great, you know, the great healing movement of the 1950s and 60s. That was an incredible movement. Some said the power was released in those days on a scale we had not seen since the day of Pentecost. Certainly some things happened that were unprecedented. And we've been in this kind of middle season, because we've got one right in front of us. Maybe we're introducing it now. Maybe we're at the very early stages now, but a huge monumental outpouring, but the season in between has been the most difficult, has it not? Let's be honest about it. Hope deferred has not been fun, right? And we have to prophesy it. We can't not prophesy the things. And I would have thought, I got to be honest, I would have thought that things would have happened before now. I would have thought by 2014 we'd be in the meat of this thing. It would be on. But you know, God knows, and there's been a delay. Say there's been delay. Let's just be honest about it. Let's don't mince words. There's been delay. And you'll notice in the book of Revelation chapter 10, when the Lord comes from heaven with the once sealed book that is now unsealed, he comes to the earth as a strong angel with a rainbow around his head, clothed in a cloud, with a now opened book in his hand, setting his foot on the land and the sea, roars as if a lion when he roars, and screams out, "There shall be delay no longer." So there's been delay. But at some point, the delay is no longer, right? And so, you know, you might say, why? Well, you know, maybe we're not ready. I'll be very honest with you. I believe the Lord has shown us that when Israel gave up Gaza, that delayed things even for the church. Because as goes Israel, so goes the church, correct? You can just see a parallel course that's been running throughout church history. When Israel first received its call to return back to the land of Israel, the Jewish people received the call to make Aliyah, is what it was called, to begin to return. It first went forth as a prophetic message. Jeremiah chapter 16 tells us that you marvel, you know, I used to be called the God that brought Israel out of Egypt with a mighty hand, but the day is coming when I'll be known as the God that brought Israel from the nations of the earth and replanted them in their land. But it goes on to say, I will first use the fishers, and what the fishers do not do, I'll use the hunters, but I will restore my people. And so here's the model, and this is the season we've been in, and hopefully it'll give you some understanding. In 1896, the time came when Israel was supposed to start making its way back to the land of Israel. And the fisher's message went out. Now, a fisher does what? He has a lure, right? He casts a lure, and he tries to pull the fish in. And so the message of Zionism is what it was called, went forth by Sham Weizmann and others. And in 1896, a man by the name of Theodor Herzl, a Jewish man, wrote a book called The Jewish State. And it was a fisher's message trying to awaken the Jewish people to return to Israel. The very same year, 1896, Alexander Dowie was commissioning his apostolic church, luring the people back to an apostolic heritage. 1896, the very same year. Is that an accident or is it in the plan of God? You cannot deny the parallel course that Israel and the church or the bride have been making throughout history. As we saw it in 1948, Israel restored as a nation. We have the great healing movement, 1967, Jerusalem comes back to the Jewish people. We have the great Jesus movement, and so on it goes. So there's been this undeniable course, and so there was a fisher's message. Now here's the part you don't like to talk about, but we have to do it because it's a matter of history. But I have read documentation that said that the fishers, the prophetic call to return to Israel brought about 42,500 people back to Israel by World War I. But what the fishers couldn't do, the hunters did. 1940s, people like Hitler and Stalin come on the scene and mass anti-Semitism, the Holocaust, butchering and slaying 6 million plus Jewish people, and not to mention what all happened throughout Russia in all those years. And because of the horror of what was discovered at the end of World War II, the nations of the earth in a single day agreed that Israel needed its own homeland so they could defend themselves. They had their own economy, their own language, and in a day a nation was born, just like the Bible said it would be. And what the fishers couldn't do, the hunters did. Because within a matter of a couple of years from Israel becoming a nation, they went from 42,000 or whatever it was to 1.5 million. And now several million people live in Israel. And the Bible predicted that one day he'd restore them to the land and restore their own language. And we have a man by the name of, Eliezer ben Yehuda, who returned to Israel in the late 1800s and reestablished the Hebrew language after it not being used for 20-something hundred years. It even goes on to say that they'll restore the shekel. Now the shekel is used as the currency of Israel, and on it goes. The land that was once a barren wasteland will become a beautiful garden. It even has in one scripture, I have all these scriptures down, I won't take the time to read it, that great fruit will come out of Israel. Now we know that 80% of Europe's fruit comes from the land of Israel, that little piece of dirt that's not as big as New Jersey. Why? Because God said so. That's the only explanation. And the reason I share all of that is this: if the Lord has been jealous for the restoration of Israel, and at the same time Israel was restored as a nation, so also was the church being lured back to her apostolic heritage, then if he sent the fishers to lure them back, he will send the hunters to lure us back. Now you might say, what does a hunter look like on the spiritual side of that? Well, sickness will drive you to healing, right? Desperation will drive you to... I think we've been in a season in some ways of dryness, we've had a lot of people sick, where people have been driven to the Word of God, right? The Lord, it's been out of necessity, we realize we need authority. We need, in other words, when everything's wonderful, we forget God. That's been the history of mankind on the whole. But we've been in a season where it's been mandatory for survival, has it not? That we begin to turn to God, begin to believe God for the miraculous. We're living in a generation now where sickness is rampant. I don't know if there's ever been a season of history where as many sick people as there are today. And so there's this driving force that has made us aware we need the gospel of the primitive church. We need the power of the early apostles. We need a visitation of the Spirit of God that fell on those 120 in the upper room. Do you agree with that? I can go on and on about that. We were talking on the way here this morning. I was reminded of something I kind of wanted to share it the other night, and I forgot. But I had this experience. It was an amazing experience because it happened in the middle of the afternoon. I had been teaching a series called Days of Noah, just as it was in the days of Noah. so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. And I was in right above Calgary, Alberta, Canada. And it was on a Friday. I'll never forget, and I was going to speak that Friday evening in the session on that message. And I got to be honest, when the Lord told me to preach Days of Noah, I did so with trepidation because I knew that I had to broach some sensitive subjects. I mean, you know, Genesis 6 is a weird chapter of the Bible. No matter what you look at, you know, the B'nai Elohim saw the B'nath Adam, and they cohabitated together and produced Nephilim. That's weird, right? The Septuagint translated that giants, but that was a mistranslation. The word really is fallen ones. So B'nai Elohim, you know, and I'm not going to teach this today, but B'nai Elohim is a reference to a created being, always. Every Jewish writer will tell you that. B'nath Adam is the daughters of mankind. So anyway, something went on in Genesis 6. And it created something that was pretty weird. And so the Lord said, I want you to preach Days of Noah. And I began to do that. And I prepared. I did a lot of historical reading. I did a lot of reading of Jewish rabbis to get a perspective of Genesis 6 and all of that. So now I'm in Alberta, Canada. I'm going to preach that message on a Friday night. So I'm sitting. Wanda happened to be in Charlotte because one of the grandbabies was being born, Jackson, the grandson. And so she was not there. So I have this big suite to myself where it has a bedroom upstairs, and the downstairs is a big living area with a couple of couches. And so I kind of liked it because my wife is a neat freak. And you know, this is a true story. I'll go to the cabinet, get a glass out of the, closet, whatever, set it down, turn around, get something out of the refrigerator. And by the time I turn back around, the glass is in the dishwasher. That has actually happened. True story. I mean, nothing lays around our house, does it, Natalie? I mean, we have some little coasters, you know, on the coffee table. And just out of fun, my son came in one day and turned one of them a little crooked. And he said, I wonder how long it's going to take Wanda to notice that. And she walks one pass through the room, and like radar vision, she went and straightened it back out. So anyway, my whole point in that is that I had all my books laid out. I had all my reference material and my study material, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And all of a sudden, something happened where the room began to fade. I'm wide awake, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm studying my notes. The room began to fade, and another room came down. Just what it looked like. I don't know how to describe that. Just like this realm didn't go away. It just kind of went into the background. And another realm came and superseded on top of that one. And one part of me knew that I was still sitting on a couch, but the main part of me realized I was standing in a football stadium. That's kind of weird, isn't it? And I'm standing facing some people sitting in a seat right here, and I hear to my left Billy Graham preaching. And I hear him giving an altar call, and I begin to hear the song Just As I Am being played. And I'm looking at this family, a man, a woman, and a boy. And it's amazing what your mind thinks about, but I knew there was the 1960s. I could tell by the way they were dressed, and because I noticed the little boy had on a little clip-on tie. Remember those? And I remember thinking, even in the vision, I thought, man, I remember those. You know, I never did like those. But I'm looking at that, so I realized that was a date. That was a time factor. I was the 1960s. And I heard Just As I Am being played, and I watched as people began to slowly, very courteously come out of their seat, and very, you know, in a very organized way, begin to walk down onto the football field to pray the prayer of salvation. I even noticed where one man stopped and let a woman go by, just being very, very quiet, very, very reverential, maybe is the right word, as they walked down onto the football field to give their life to the Lord. And then all of a sudden, I heard a voice say, "What's coming will not be like that." Not that there won't be salvation, it just won't be quite like that. So the next minute, I'm up on a podium. Like this, with a microphone in my left hand, as it is now. And it was a much bigger room than this, but the whole altar area was filled with cots and gurneys. I told this story in England one time and got to the end of the story, and they said, "What is a cot and a gurney?" You know what I'm talking about when I said cot and a gurney? Okay. People were lying on them dying. Right, you know, right over here, there was a man sitting in a wheelchair with his feet elevated and his legs and feet were curled under like this. Over next to him, I noticed a man lying there with a tumor protruding from his abdomen. And I just noticed these people all lying around that were extremely ill and sick. And I thought, you know what, they're here because there was an anticipation that something was about to come into the building and they were going to be healed. So, that, you know, my deal is, why isn't the altar filled right now, right? We need to move into a healing movement where the altars are filled with sick people, where every service somebody gets out of a wheelchair, somebody gets off a cot, somebody gets open, have their eyes open. And so I'm believing for that. And we're doing the best we can until that comes, but it's going to happen. And so I'm watching all of that. I'm making that observation. I noticed the two or three over here, particularly like the guy in the wheelchair. And about that time, I'm standing a little bit more over here when that happens. And right over here, the double doors of the back of the church burst open. And this is all happening in my suite. And a family of people start walking down the aisle, and maybe five or six, I didn't count them, but maybe five or six people. And they were trying to restrain a little girl. I wasn't always sure. I'm pretty sure it was a little girl, about 16 years old. Screaming profanities. Screaming profanities. And they're trying to restrain her. And she's throwing these five or six people around like they were nothing. And a man spoke up out of the group and he said, "Somebody had better be here that can deal with this." Just like that. And I said, "Yeah, somebody needs to deal with that." And guess who's got the microphone? And I realized, you know, I got to deal with this. So I came off the podium. I had two thoughts. I can still remember them right now as clear as anything. My first thought was, I don't have time to call for the blood sisters. You know, the Holy Ghost ladies that know how to get a hold of God. I had no time to call for the sisters. Those ladies that know how to go into tongues in 2 seconds, right? You know, my wife can do that. She can go, Holy Ghost tongue. I don't have time to call for the intercessors. I don't have time to call for a day of prayer and fasting. They're coming down the aisle. That was my first thought. My second thought was, a mere gift of the Spirit is not enough to deal with this. Don't take it that I'm minimizing the importance of gifts. But my thought was, I don't want just a gift. I want Christ in me, the hope of glory. Lord, I'm about to turn the corner here, and I want you inside of me to deal with what's coming down the aisle, right? So I feel like that's kind of an admonition. We need more than a gift-oriented ministry. We need a presence-driven ministry, right? And so I turned the corner, and when I did, I looked at the little girl. I got, you know, right here, but I was on the floor, and I looked at the girl, and inside of the little girl was a 12-foot being, evil spirit. Remember, I'm teaching just as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man, when there were giants on the earth. And so something happened at the flood, and these things became evil spirits, and this little girl was possessed, if that's the right word, by something from hell. And so I met them in the aisle, and I'm not saying I'm there yet, so don't take it that I'm saying I have great authority, because I'm not saying that. I believe we will. But I turned and I pointed my right finger, and I said, "Be gone." Two words. I didn't ask its name. I didn't repeat myself. I didn't say, you know, "Come out 14 times. I didn't yell it. I just said, "Be gone." And it was gone. And I knew this apostolic authority that's coming to us is necessary to deal with this sort of thing. I remember I told that story one time in a meeting, and Bobby said, "That's the exact same words Jesus said to the devil, 'Be gone.'" And so I said, "Be gone." And that thing left. And as soon as I did, that same audible voice that had spoken earlier said this: "What has previously been relegated to India and Africa is coming to America, and somebody had better get authority with me in a hurry." Now, since I've preached that, I can tell you numerous testimonies of things of that caliber that have happened. What happened to a friend of mine in Anniston, Alabama, where literally I had just shared this story, and he didn't know it. I had just shared in Alberta. And that following Sunday, he said, a family walks into the church, gets to the foyer, and a little teenage girl falls on the floor, starts foaming at the mouth, screaming and all that. And I said, "What did you do?" He said, "I went back, cast out the devil, led her to the Lord, and baptized her," all in the same service. I had another friend, a lady by the name of Barbara Yoder. You might know her from Michigan. I'll be with her in 2 weeks, 3 weeks. And she heard that message. I was really honored because I think a lot of her as a ministry, and she had an appendicitis, and I think it got infected or something, so they did surgery, and she was going to be laid up for 2 weeks. And she said, "Lord, what do you want me to listen to while I'm laid up?" And the Lord said, "I want you to listen to Paul Key stuff." I thought, wow, I mean, I was just so honored by that. So she listened to that story, and so she said, "You know what? And she began to pray a prayer. She said, I don't want a devil to be able to sit in my service quietly anymore. I don't want somebody to sit there uninfluenced by the anointing with a devil. And so, of course, she said, you know, obviously that started happening. So she was standing at the altar one day, and she said, this man, you know, seemed like he looked okay, you know, nice enough, started walking towards her. And this is what she said. I'm going to quote her. She said, he got about 6 or 7 feet from her, jumped up in the air, and without touching the ground, flew into her and kicked her in the chest. Now, she's not a big lady. She's kind of, and she said, Paul Keith, he knocked me right on my derriere. Look that one up in Webster's. You'll figure out what the. I said, what did you do? She said, I hopped up and cast that devil out. It made me mad. You know, we need to get a little righteous indignation, right? So I'm prophesying to you that we're about to move into a season of apostolic authority. I want to talk for just a minute. Can I do that about the apostolic? I love the commissioning of the Apostle Paul. I'm not getting too excited, but if I get too excited, I get too hot. So I'm just kind of being mellow this morning. But, you know, the Apostle Paul's commissioning, I had an experience with it years ago, because the real hero of that story was Ananias. In Acts chapter 9, you see Saul of Tarsus. Let me just share a vision with you that might help you, because I had some people ask me a question. I think one of the keys to what's coming is this issue of divine justice. You know, John saw the Lord Jesus in a certain way. I shared it last night, right? Where he saw him standing among the 7 golden lampstands. He saw him with a robe reaching to his feet, with a golden sash, hair as white as wool like snow, eyes like flames of fire, his face shining like the brightness of the sun, his voice like the sound of many waters, his feet like burnished bronze, and 7 stars in his right hand. The same image Daniel saw in Daniel 7 when he saw the Ancient of Days. And the Lord, and John saw the Lord as the judge, as the supreme deity judge. And that's very important, because he saw him at the end of the church ages, when the Lord Jesus will take his seat and begin to render a verdict in favor of the saints, and the saints will take possession of the kingdom. In the book of Daniel chapter 7, it says, the horn of the adversary has waged war with the saints and overpowered them until the Ancient of Days renders a verdict in favor of the saints, and the saints take possession of the kingdom. I would like a verdict to be rendered in my behalf, wouldn't you? A few years ago, I had a friend that died. He was 38 years old, pastor friend of mine. And I had shared a lot of this apostolic stuff at his church, and he died, 38 years old. He was a good friend of mine. He called me every day. And when he called, you know, it was an hour-long commitment, you know, just about to talk. But I really liked him, so I tried to talk as much as I could. But he died at the age of 38. And I never understood why. So I said, Lord, I have a lot of acquaintances, but I don't have a lot of friends, people that I really consider a friend and open up to, because I don't do that very easily. And I had a friend. He died. I want to understand it. I went into a vision. And in the vision, I'm watching the book of Acts scenario when Stephen, and this guy's name was Stephen Kinney. And so I'm watching Stephen. Of course, I didn't put the two and two together until later, but I'm watching Stephen being stoned in an open vision. And I understood the mentality of the people, because I knew that the mentality of the people was, here is Stephen about to be stoned, but he's God's number one man. He's the bright rising star of the church. You know, he's going to take the place of Peter, James, and John. He was healing the sick and casting out devils and doing all the work of ministry, and yet here he is being stoned. And so they thought, this can't happen. God's not going, but he was. And, of course, we know that Saul of Tarsus was the one that had authority, right, to have him stoned. And so in my vision, just as Stephen was being stoned, just as the last stones were hitting him, I saw the scenario that's described in the Bible where Stephen is just about to die. He looks up into heaven, and he sees the Lord Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father. Remember that? But in my vision, when Stephen looked into heaven, the Lord Jesus stood up on the right side of the hand of the Father, pointed his finger at the devil, and said, that one is going to cost you. Just like that. It scared me. I was in a vision. It scared me. Just the authority. That one is going to cost you, is what he told the devil. And all of a sudden, I saw a spiritual dynamic in my vision. I saw that the stoning of Stephen meant the reaping of Paul. The sowing of Stephen meant the reap. In other words, because of divine justice, the devil took God's number one man, so God took his. And I saw in my vision, this is, that everything the Apostle Paul did, Stephen shared in the fruit. I'm convinced Stephen knew that something was going to happen by him being yielded. I believe that. And, of course, my friend's name was Stephen. And so here is now the Apostle Paul who has no idea he's a pawn in this big chess game between God and the devil. He was the devil's number one. No one was doing more harm to the church than he was. I'm sure the church was saying, oh, Lord, bless Saul of Tarsus. Bless him right in the head with a bolt of lightning, you know, or something to that effect. You know, nobody knew that he was going to be one of the greatest apostles that ever lived. That's why we can't pull up the tares because we don't know if it's a tare or a wheat. What we think is a sure thing is a tare might be a great wheat. So we just have to go along with the process until God reveals it. But then Saul of Tarsus is on his way to Damascus, and he has this experience where the Lord appears to him in a vision. And I love this whole scenario because in Acts chapter 9 it says, you know, Saul of Tarsus has a vision. He sees the Lord and he screams out, "Who are you, Lord?" You hear a distress in his voice. And he said, "I'm Jesus, the one you're persecuting." I'm pretty sure he went, "Oops." Whatever the Hebrew is for oops, I'm pretty sure that's what he said it. "I'm persecuting the very God I claim to serve." That would be a good day and a bad day. And so he's blinded and he goes into a certain place and he's praying and fasting because he's blinded. And the same time, you find about three or four verses later, a man by the name of Ananias. And Ananias turns around, and there stands the Lord Jesus, just like he had appeared to Saul of Tarsus. But he says, "Here am I, Lord." Isn't that a different salutation? So apparently Ananias was accustomed to seeing the Lord. We can draw that conclusion to some degree because of his reaction. And I'm sure he said, "Here, my Lord, what would you have me do? I want you to go down and lay hands on a man." "Oh, Lord." You know, I'm pretty sure the Lord said, "I want to bless you, Ananias. I want to bless you. I'm here to bless you." "Oh, praise the Lord. What would you like for me to do?" "I want you to go down to a house on the street called Straight. There's a man down there that's been blinded. He met me on the road to Damascus. And I want you to lay hands on him because his name is Saul of Tarsus." I'm pretty sure Ananias went, "I thought you wanted to bless me. I heard about that guy. He likes to kill people like me." And the Lord, and I'm sure Ananias was a good charismatic. He says, "So give me a word for him." "Okay, Ananias, go tell him how much he's going to suffer for my sake." I'm sure he went, "That'll do it. You know, that'll do it." So he does it anyway, right? He goes in, and I love the commissioning. Ananias comes, he says, "Brother Saul." And this is the apostolic commissioning I believe many are about to receive. I'm convinced the Lord has shown this to me. That there's about to be a number of people, not just one. I don't know who, I don't know where, but a number of people are about to be commissioned in the order of Paul. Where Ananias goes to him, he lays his hands upon him, the scales fall off his eyes, his eyesight returns. Ananias says, "Brother Saul, the God of our fathers has called you to know his will." The very first thing we need to understand as an apostolic community is to know the will of God. That would be novel, would it not? Wouldn't that transform the way we do church? Just knowing the will of God. You will know his will. You will see the righteous one. You will hear utterances from his lips. And you'll be a testifier or a witness of what you've seen and heard. I want you to say, "I can do that." Say, "I can do that." I want you to see something. I want you to hear something. And I want you to go testify of what you've seen and heard. That was his apostolic commissioning. You're going to know his will. And I believe in this hour in which we're living, we must be able to testify, give witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I personally believe you'll see the Lord. If somebody doesn't believe that, that's okay. If you don't believe it, an apostle. But I believe that's the heritage of an apostle, that we're going to stand before the people, because that's what Israel had to do. That's what the Jewish guys in the early church had to do. They had to stand before the Sanhedrin. Where I can tell you with a certainty, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, he's resurrected from the dead, because number one, I saw him last week. Number two, he's doing through me what he did when he walked the earth in human form, releasing resurrection life. And this whole idea of knowing the will of God, knowing what he wants done with the word of God. One of the prophecies that came out of the 1950s was that the evidence of the bride of Christ is that she will have the word and she'll know what he wants done with the word. And that would be a novel way of us beginning to approach the church. The purpose of the Apostolic Church is to carry out the letter and the spirit of the New Testament gospel as Christ and the apostles establish it, and to continue to ordain such persons as God has called and qualified to carry apostolic commissioning as it was commissioned by the Lord himself in Matthew 16, 19. In other words, it's not a matter of one person being apostolic. It's a matter of that person commissioning others to become apostolic, sending them out two by two. In other words, the model for this new apostolic ministry will be, are you a church? Yes. Are you an equipping center? Yes. Are you a missionary base? Yes. Are you a resource center? Yes. I mean, it's going to be all of the above. There's not going to be one identifying factor. Being a church as we have known it is about to be a foreign idea. I'm going to let that sink in a minute because I don't want you to, church as we have known it is going to become a foreign idea to this community of people. Because of the main thing that's going to come out of that is koinonia, fellowship. It's going to be a relational model, not a hierarchy. And we know that to be a true apostle, you're empowering the people to do what they're called to do, right? And if you don't have as your goal, the main thing is to equip somebody to be sent out to carry out what you've been revealed to do, then you're not really doing the work of ministry. Did I share it the other night about the Nicolaitans? Did I talk about that? Where God hates the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. It comes from two Greek words, to conquer. Some people think they were followers of Nicholas. That really is not the case. It was the Nico conquer the laity. And there was a whole season of church history where the concept of empowering the laity was foreign. But now we understand this new apostolic model is for the apostle to be underneath the pyramid, empowering the people above to go out and do the work of ministry. It says in Matthew 16, 19, I will give you the keys of the kingdom, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Can I just kind of read some very fast things? I know time's running short. The keys of the kingdom open spiritual doors, accessing the power, gifts, and promises of God. You might say, well, what does that look like? Well, back at the turn of the 20th century, there was certain people, one particular, that God gave them a key to divine healing. The man's name was Alexander Dow. He wasn't the only one, but he did more in the turn of the 20th century to promote the idea of divine healing than any other ministry there was. And he said the Lord, in an experience, gave him a key to unlock the door to the revelation that God still heals. And just think of all the different perspectives we have today, all these doors and access that will be given to the bride of Christ. You know, doors of fellowship, doors of intimacy, doors of union, doors of the mysteries of the kingdom, doors of secrets that were hidden in times past revealed, doors to unlock books and poems and spiritual songs that will be written that are in the heart of God. Many of these keys literally access his heart. For many centuries, the door of divine healing seemed shut and locked, and ministers taught it was shut forever. But God, in his infinite goodness and mercy, sent the revelation that functions as a key to unlock the door to release the revelation of divine healing. I'm going to just read a couple more real quickly. We must all pray that the apostolic church would fulfill the purpose for which it was commissioned, that is, the glory of the eternal Father through our Lord and Savior, so that the Holy Spirit may work in the church and enable us to fulfill the great commission for which Christ came to the earth, that is, the salvation, healing, cleansing, and redemption of man from sin, disease, death, and hell, and the coming together of the redeemed into one great, glorious temple for God. God's building a temple. It was kind of an amazing thing happened in 1995 going into 1996. And I feel like it has to do with this whole apostolic ministry. But I received a phone call from Bob Jones late 1995. And he had just had one of his visions. And we've talked about Bob, so I hope you know that he was a prophetic man. And he said, I had this strange vision. He shared some of the aspects of the vision. But then he said, I had something strange happen. He said, in this vision, I was given the date January the 16th. He said, I have no idea what that means. And I said, I do. I said, because on January the 16th, 1956, a man stood up in Chicago, Illinois, and said the revival was over, that that the people were more captured by the phenomena of God than the person of God, this apostolic movement, this apostolic awareness, the door was closed, and we were about to go into another season of church history. But all that happened on January 16th, 1956, when this prophet said, America has turned down our opportunity. And so this was late 1995, when we realized that January was coming around the corner. So we called up Rick Joyner, and we said, Rick, you know, we feel like we're supposed to have a meeting on January the 16th. And so he invited several people, Mahesh and Bonnie Shavda, you may have heard of them, myself and Wanda and Bob and Viola Jones and Bobby Connor and Paul Kane and some others. And we were all going to meet on January the 16th, 1956, to find out what this was all about. Well, on January the 10th, 1996, 6 days before that, Bob calls me up again. He said, I had another vision. I said, what was the vision? He said, well, I saw three men in a teller line, like a bank teller line. And he said, I saw that the first two men received a check from the Lord, but they squandered their check. But he said, those two men are coming to our meeting the 16th. I said, who are they? He said, I have no idea. I said, where are they coming from? He said, I have no idea. He said, but they're coming to the meeting on January the 16th. So we, and he told about the third person in the line, which would actually unlock the door to what we're talking about now, begin to release something in our generation about apostolic ministry. So we go to the meeting now. We're in Moravian Falls, North Carolina. We're meeting on the morning of January the 16th. And, of course, you know, Bob is like a bulldog with a bone sometimes. He's like, well, there's two men that are supposed to come. Now, you got to realize, 1996, Moravian Falls, if you know anything about it, was not well known. I mean, very few buildings were built there. Nobody knew about it. It was kind of hidden at that time. And so it's not like people would travel through there all the time. You understand? And so Bob that morning says, well, we really can't start the meeting until these two men show up. So Rick Joyner says, what two men? He said, I don't know. He said, well, who are they? He said, I don't know. Where are they coming from? I don't know. And Rick said, well, you do know this is an invitation-only meeting. And everybody who's invited is here, so how are two people we don't know coming to this meeting that's an invitation-only? Bob said, I don't know, but we can't start the meeting until they get here. It was kind of driving us crazy a little bit. It was just kind of like, come on, Bob. So we just kind of kill the morning, really. Break for lunch. We go back in the afternoon. I'm kind of taking the long story because I want you to be impressed with what happened. So about 2 o'clock in the afternoon, we go back and we start the meeting. And so Rick just says, well, Paul, can you just share why we're here? So I started telling the story like I've told you. I got a phone call from Bob. He got the date, January 16th. I knew what that meant because I had studied some stuff. I knew on January 16th, 1956, this is 1996, right? 40 years to the day, back around. America had turned down our opportunity. And while I'm telling that story, we hear a knock on the door. The door opens and two men walk in. Bob says, there they are. It's pretty amazing. So these two men come in and sit down. And Bob said, I had a vision of the two of you. And he said, I knew you were supposed to be here today. So this is a divine appointment. Turns out the two men had been doing a missionary journey. They had driven from Florida to New York, visiting churches they knew along the way, turned around, and were on their way back down to Florida, and just on a whim decided to drive to Moravian Falls to see who was there. One man was Ray Kirschke, who was a 77-year-old man in 1996. The other was a man named Erskine Holt, who has now died and gone to heaven. I didn't know who they were until then, and so they sit down. So now I'm retelling the whole story all over again. We're here because Bob had a vision on January 16th. I know something. So I get to the part. I said, you know, Bob had this word about January 16th. And I said that there was a prophet who spoke in Chicago, Illinois on January 16th, 1956, and said America has turned down his opportunity. When I said that, the 77-year-old man raised his hand and said, I was in that meeting. That's what we said. He said, I was in that meeting. We were stunned. I said, you were in the, he said, yeah. He said, I am the last disciple of John G. Lake. He said, John G. Lake spent the last 18 months of his life training me. I was the last disciple of John G. Lake before he died. He said, I had always wanted to hear that prophet. And he said, I only heard him once. He said, I happened to be in Chicago. And he said, I remember his message like it was yesterday. I cannot forget it for anything. Began to tell some of the details why. So here now, think about this just for a minute now. We're in this meeting, January 16, 1996, 40 years to the day, right? And a person that was in the meeting, I found out later, only about 400 or 500 people were in the meeting in 1956. So how many of them are alive, number one? And number two, how can anybody find their way to a remote cabin in Moravian Falls, North Carolina, 40 years to the day from the day of the meeting, and be prophesied by a prophet they were going to be there? You got a little faith that was God? Well, then this is what I want you to have faith to believe. He said, I feel like I'm here to pass the apostolic torch. From John G. Lake to the 1950s to the present hour. He was a bridge between two eras of church history. And so we have some pictures where he's laying his hands on us and praying for us. And I know that was 1996. But you know what? You can't make that up. And so I know. You know, I believe John G. Lake was called the Apostle of Faith. And he went down to South Africa, and transformed a nation. There are still churches today called Apostolic Faith Churches that were birthed by John G. Lake. The miraculous, the miracles, the revelation, and the story of John G. Lake, how he entered into his apostolic commissioning, is pretty amazing. He had been commissioned by Alexander Dowie to do ministry, to heal the sick, and he was seeing miracles on a scale that he had never imagined. But yet he was more hungry for God even then than ever before, is what he said. So he began to pray and fast for 9 months. After a season of prayer and fasting, he said he went to a woman's house to pray for her. He sat down in a chair, and when he did, the visible, tangible glory of God came in him and around him for 6 feet and remained. He said, I became a Christ man. That was his language. That almost sounds, you know, a little bit brash to say, but that was what he said. I became a Christ man. He said, no longer do I just demonstrate the power of God. I am an express image and radiate his person, his nature, and his character. That sounds strong, but the evidence of it was there, right? And that was his apostolic commission. So I'm believing, I'm going to say something, and this is me, but I believe being an apostle is much more than going to a meeting and have somebody fill out a piece of paper and pray over you and say you're an apostle. I have a feeling becoming an apostle means somewhere along the way, you and the Lord collide. Is that okay to say? I just don't believe that we can go have an apostolic conference and everybody sit under a teaching for 2 or 3 days, and at the end of the conference, we just pray for him, and all of a sudden now you're an apostle. There may be, you know, one person said, well, there's little A apostles and there's big A apostles. Little A apostles are commissioned by men. Big A apostles are commissioned by Christ. I'm going to go for the big A. I'm prophesying the big A apostles are about to be here. I believe there has to be a place where a true apostle and the Lord become one. I believe that. You need to understand something. We relate to God as a son, but we relate to the earth in an office. In other words, you don't go to God as an apostle. You go to him as a son. Or you ladies, you might say you're a daughter, but it's not about gender. You realize it, right? Because sonship is the word becoming flesh. The word of God manifested in flesh. Male flesh, female flesh, white flesh, black flesh, Asian flesh, Native American flesh, like what I am, Cherokee Indian. Whatever it happens to be, he just wants to manifest himself in humanity, right? That makes you a son of the kingdom. One day the word of God went to the Jordan. Am I losing you? I know this is probably deep for a Sunday morning message, but one day the word, Jesus was the word, went into the Jordan River. When he came out of the Jordan, the heavens opened, the Spirit descended, the word and the Spirit became one, and the Father said, this is my beloved Son. So every time he went to the Father, he says, my Father, which art in heaven. But when he got his instructions from his Father, he then went out and he was the apostle of our faith. He functioned as the Son of Man. He functioned as a healer and as a rabbi, as a teacher. So you relate to the people and offices, you relate to God as a son or a bride, right? So this apostolic reformation is going to be people that have met God and are living in a union experience with God. Listen, I may have mentioned this earlier, but I'll say it again. The Lord's been talking to me in recent weeks about my, at least my misunderstanding. Maybe you didn't have this, but I used to think what a sacrifice it must have been for the Lord Jesus to minister all day long, you know, and then at the end of the day, go out and pray all night. Because I'm envisioning, here's prayer life, what mine is kind of like. Because, you know, sometimes prayer's not a lot of fun, right? Come on now, can I be honest? You know, sometimes it's wonderful, but, you know, I believe it can be different than the way we've understood it. I believe it's not just having a prayer list and going out and, you know, and praying and all of a sudden your mind wanders off to something else and you're thinking about the grocery store and taking care of the kids and, oh, I got to get back to prayer. I believe there's another level of a prayer life that we're supposed to walk in. And the Lord told me, or the Holy Spirit told me recently, he said, you have a complete misunderstanding of the Lord's prayer life. He didn't do that out of discipline. He went out at the end of the day after ministering all day long to be with his Father because it was his reward. going out and praying all night was the Lord's reward. Think about that for just a minute. Then I had this revelatory thing where I realized when the Lord went out to pray, he quieted his flesh and he went right to the presence of the Father. And for hours he stood in the presence of his Father with the Shekinah glory of God falling on him. And he and the Father had fellowship, and they had union. They talked about what they had done that day. They talked about what he's going to do tomorrow. They talked about his life and his destiny. They talked about the revelation. He stood in the very presence of Almighty God for hours at a time. And I'm pretty sure he's like, oh, no, it's daylight. I got to come out of this place and go, you know. So now here's my deal about saying that is I believe that I can live in that place. I believe that you can live in that place. I believe this apostolic community of people that we're going to see today can come into a place of union with God where they look for the hour when they can go and spend time in fellowship. You might say, well, didn't he need sleep? Well, apparently not, because it says Moses stood in the presence of God and his eyes did not grow dim, his flesh did not, his strength was not abated, and his clothes didn't even wear out. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So the whole apostolic community of people coming forth that are in a union, you might say, man, that must be good for Bob and Kathy Campbell. No, that's for anybody who's willing to contend for it and believe for it, right? I believe that. I wouldn't share that with you this morning if I didn't believe the people I'm talking to right now, before this thing is over with, will have that experience. I believe it. I want to be one of them. I just want to be one of those. I want to keep prophesying until it begins to happen. We're going to live in a time of apostolic reformation. Amen? Amen. I have so much more, but I feel like I want to stop right there. I just feel like that's a good stopping point. What I want to pray this morning, you know, this is a Sunday morning, I realize that, but I felt some anointing when I talked about that. I want to pray for your prayer life. I want to pray for your prayer life. I want to pray because I've gone through seasons where I could spend 2 and 3 and 4 hours at a time sitting in my chair. Now, you know, I'm going to be honest with you. You know, we don't have to be religious about this. One time I had a guy tell me, he's from India. He says, if you really want to meet God, you have to pray on your knees. So I tried that. After about an hour, I was in so much pain. If God showed up, I wouldn't have known it. I mean, honestly, I hurt so bad. I'm like, you know, this is no fun. And I found a scripture. It's in the Bible, in the book of Psalms, and David sat before the Lord. So I sit before the Lord. Now, you know, you might, when you get to worship, you might jump up and down and shout. That might be your personality. What I do, the more anointed I get, the more still I get. That's like when I'm worshiping over here, the more I feel the anointing, the more, because I'm trying to go somewhere. I'm trying to keep my flesh still so I can go somewhere, see something or whatever. So however you do, it's your business. But I believe there's an anointing here this morning for your prayer life to not be arduous and difficult and laborious, but to be free and fun and full of revelation. Do you believe that? So, Lord, I just pray that right now all over this room. And I feel like some of you have been really... I actually feel like there's a couple of people that have been beating yourself up a little bit because prayer has not been fun at all, and you felt a little guilty. I'm going to ask you, if that's you, just stand up, because I feel like there's going to be some deliverance there, and that's okay. It's okay to believe that way, because I feel like God just told me he's going to break that off right now. He's going to break that off all over this room. I'm not going to lay hands on everybody because it's Sunday morning. I know you've got to go, but I'm just believing right now for a release of the anointing that's going to shift and change your prayer life forever. Never again being the same. I just, right now, just receive it. Just receive that anointing, that you're going to look forward to it. You're not going to be guilty if you, you know, you're not going to feel this weight that you felt before. It's going to be broken off right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. And I release a revelation of what it means to sit in the presence of God. Listen, a lot of it does start by faith. You might say, I don't feel a thing. You know, the Bible says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's the word of God. That means he's there whether you feel it or not. And you start believing that, you'll begin to sense it. He said, I'll be with you, even in you, until the end of the age. That is the absolute, undeniable word of God. So whether we feel a goosebump experience or not, he's there. He's standing right by your side when you pray. You need to begin to have an awareness of that. You need to have a faith to believe that. And when you do, things will begin to come into fruition. You'll begin to feel the conscious awareness and presence of God. Lord, release that for these that are standing especially, but though anyone in this room, we just release a fresh anointing on the prayer life of these people. If you're not able to speak in tongues, I'm going to pray right now that God will release that to you, that you'll begin to speak in tongues. I believe in speaking in tongues. If you don't feel guilty if you don't, but I believe it's a wonderful tool, right? And you don't have to do it in public. You can do it right by yourself. And, you know, I don't do it in public. If I do, you know, the rapture's on the way. But anyway, but, you know, you can be filled with the Holy Ghost right now. You know, if that's you and you haven't received a prayer language, just kind of stand to your feet as well, along with these others. And I want you to begin to receive that. I saw a couple of people stand. So we just release the anointing right now for these. Lord, let the... There it is, right there. Let the anointing flow for her and these others that are in this room. Let there be an amazing presence that comes right now as they begin to pray, as their heart will burn within them as they set aside time to begin to fellowship with the Lord. I would even encourage you to lay aside your prayer list. The Bible says, I know what you have need of even before you say it. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, and all these things will be added to you. In other words, go to prayer to have fellowship. There it is, young man. There's your anointing right there. Let the anointing come over these people. Just a fresh release. If we can get that right this morning, it'll transform your life forever and forever to begin to have fellowship with God. Grant that, I pray, all over this room. I release it right now. Overshadowing of your spirit to fill her up tonight, today. That the prayer life would flow. Let it flow like a river. We just break off any religious spirits that have somehow given a false perception of what prayer life is all about. So I release this. There it is, sir. I just felt the anointing when I touched your head. I felt a release for you right down through your head into the soles of your feet. So grant it, God. Release it, I pray, in the name of the Lord Jesus for these people. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, I pray that not only that, but that while they pray, that great revelation will come. Great revelation, the revelation of Jesus Christ, the revelation of who you are in him and who he is in you. Lord, I love the gifts of the Spirit, but I want Christ in me, the hope of glory. I release that here. I just release an anointing right now to begin to teach on the apostolic like it's never been taught on before. Lord, I pray that great revelation will come out of this church, out of this pulpit, that authority will be given. I'm telling you, people are going to start bringing severely demon-possessed people. That's why I shared that story. I really believe you're going to begin to see some serious demon-possessed people coming, and you're going to set them free. Wouldn't that be wonderful to see the captive set free? So, Lord, I release it all over the room. I just release it all over the room right now. I'm closing, but I don't feel the close yet. So, Lord, release it. You gonna bring your family down? You want me to pray for you? Yes, go ahead. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we might know your will. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, sure. Oh, yeah, absolutely. This is your gang, all right? Yeah. All right, good. Yeah, I already prayed for you, didn't I? I didn't realize that was your wife. Lord, I just bless this family right now. I release the anointing of the Holy Spirit to begin to flood his heart, that something will be ignited in his soul that'll burn and never go out. That's what when I put my hand right there, I felt a flame ignited. Something God's going to ignite, something's going to reveal, and it's going to burn. It's not going to go out. And so, Lord, I just release that into them. Use them in profound ways. There's your anointing right there. Thank you. I just what I saw. I saw these young people coming, and I saw you give them a word. And you know, it doesn't have to be a religious word. It doesn't have to be "Thus saith the Lord." You know, just use the Holy Spirit and the anointing to direct them. But I saw both of you involved, though. So I think it, you know, I know if you're a teacher, that's part of it. But there's something else that's coming. So Lord, release them, I pray. It, Lord. Well, Lord, I just thank you for everybody here. I pray you will bless us. Bless us, everyone. Bless all that have come this Sunday morning. I pray, Lord, that by this time next year, nobody in this room will be the same. I believe I have some faith for that prayer, that you're not going to be, that 1 year from today, you're going to look back and say, wow, look where we've come. Look where we've come as an individual, as a ministry, whatever. I'm going to release that word in the Spirit. The change is coming, individually and corporately. Change is coming. We're not going to be the same. We're on the move. The cloud is moving. And I pray that we would follow in behind the cloud and your appointed leadership, and we'd get behind the vision, we'd get behind the purposes and release it, Lord, that our lives will not be the same. I'm not going to be in the same place with God a year from now that I am now. It's going to be better. It's going to be more fruitful. It's going to be more revelation. So I thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name.
You blessed? Yes, there was a lot this weekend, wasn't there? And I often say more is caught than taught. And I'm believing that God just stuffs it in me and gives us everything that we need to proceed. I'm reminded of a dream I had maybe back 2000, somewhere 1, 2 in there, where we were taken into this room with all these nurses, and they were waiting for the doctor to come, and they had this huge key that they wanted to give to us. It was Bob and I in the room, and the doctor came in, and it was the Lord, and he took us down to this huge vault, and he said, "Before I give you this key, I need you to honor those that have gone on before you." And so the way that we handle, I believe, the bones of those that have gone on before, but even those who are alive today, I believe is of utmost importance. And so I've prayed many times, God, take that critical thing out of me, where I can look from the outside in and make judgments that I know nothing of. How many of you know that's an easy thing to do as humans? And I do believe there's a healing movement coming. I want it with all my heart. I want it. I want God to outpour. And I want to see even the severely possessed delivered and free. And I remember a prophet coming in here one time and said this would be a house that would specialize with cancer. And I want all of it. I don't know, as he talked about the delay, I said to the Lord, is there anything that, you know, that we've been critical of that we need to repent of? Like, I remember one time going into a prayer meeting. We were over meeting in the little building over here in the late 90s, and God said to me, you need to repent for jumping on that bandwagon of criticizing the faith movement. And I did. I knew nothing about the faith movement. And I jumped on it. It's just a name it, claim it, blab it, grab it group. All they were after was money. And I said what everybody else was saying. And I remember calling everybody to repent that day, not even knowing what that was all about. And then I started reading Hagin's stuff, Kenneth Hagin's. And I fell in love with that man. I was like, yes, I love this teaching. It's so solid and it's Bible. Yes? And I really believe we are in that day. See, we have to work together to see the kingdom established. And I want everything God has for me. And so I do believe there's keys that are going to be given. I believe that apostolic commissioning, we are right here at the door. It does matter what we say. I mean, I went off of Facebook for a while because I got tired of seeing all the critics out there. I mean, they criticize anybody that moves. You know what I'm talking about? And see, God wants us to be able to carry His presence, to be a lover of His presence, and to desire more and more of Him. So, God, I ask that You do that within our hearts. See, some people, the way they present their case and they're so critical, it's like they're constipated or something. I pray, God, clean us out and cause us to go after His presence and honor those that have given their lives. Lord, I pray that You help us to understand the season and that we walk out, Lord, of these doors today with a new, fresh revelation that we are entering a brand new season. And I want everything You have for us, God. Every one of us have attended and come because we want all that You have. And so, God, we receive it by faith. We receive even Paul Keith and what he poured out to us. God, we're thankful for the deposit that's within him. God, we ask that more and more and more we would arise and shine, for our light has come. We bless Your name, Lord Jesus, and we thank You for tabernacling among us.